pretty good parody of a UT song on the record itself. And there's lots of stuff. Something you should try to find is the Negativland UT record. Negativland was consequently sued by SST for putting out this book called the Letter U Numeral 2, which reprinted all the legal documents and went back and forth between everybody, including the ones at the record company. So their former record company, SST, got upset about that and was also suing them. They really didn't have any money at all. And so Sealand, which did exist before SST became the sole label for, U2, the other group, Negativland. Mm-hmm. you may be wondering about this. Let's just keep going here. Presenter mean me. ever since, well, back in the 60s and 70s, there were things called slide presentations, which I always hated. I always hated the clunk. I always hated the fact that your viewing was compartmentalized into time units of discrete, unchanging hunks that somebody else decided. So if you went to a building like this with probably tons of slide presentations, there probably still are of paintings. And you see one painting after another that the lecturer presents. And I just found it so inferior to having a book where you could turn the page whenever you wanted to. So I really hated the clunk that slide projectors made. So now PowerPoint presentations are sort of like slide presentations, although usually back in those slide presentations, they didn't have words on every page, and they didn't have the person that was making the presentation reading the words for you. So when I started making a PowerPoint presentation like this, two things crossed my mind. One was Michael Snow's wonderful film, So Is This, which is 45 minutes in a silent film of one word after another, just like you saw there, which I both have to mention because Mike gets upset anytime I steal that idea and use it for something, and two, because it's quite wonderful and you should see the film sometime. But there's more. That wasn't the end of it. I probably should have not interrupted. That's in reference to, does anybody remember what was before the or better? Okay, we'll leave it at that. We'll keep going. The only reason these guys are here, is because this PowerPoint presentation was originally started to be put together as part of an autobiographical lecture that I was giving in Barcelona a little while ago. And one of my earlier musical memories was watching the Beatles on Ed Sullivan's show. And one of my first Plunderphonics pieces had something to do with the Beatles. And this used to make a sound, sound check, if you were giving me an stop doing that, so it's a little easy, but. Well, let's just get the sound part. About the same time, in fact, 2 years before that particular appearance, I got my first musical instrument. What I've always thought was my first musical instrument, and that's it, I still have it. It's an eight-cylinder, an eight-transistor radio, as it says on it. Some of those up in the left hand, it's obliterated a little bit there by the edge of the plastic, but it says, standard broadcast below that says short wave. And the short wave part of it was something that I found most fascinating, and I spent hours and hours just tuning the thing, which is why, without being able to play the musical example that I've got on there right now, which is just short wave sounds, which is a little bit harder to find on a short wave radio these days, unfortunately. It's become a bit of a wasteland. But back then it was full of stuff. It was, I guess, the international way of getting information and transmissions in real time. So it was, I guess in a way similar to the internet. And it was totally audio, and it was totally confusing for me. So I remember one sound that I really liked was this one that went, and I probably listened to that for hours on several occasions. And it's not because I thought it was a particularly nice sound, but I was pretty sure that what it was a propeller-driven airplane that was flying, and they had their radio on. So I was just listening and waiting for landing instructions. The air-to-ground kind of things, which I never heard. But it was many, many years later that I found out that there were jamming signals. And in particular, here in Canada, they were jamming broadcasts from Cuba. It was one of the more prevalent places where they had to put up a blockade so you couldn't hear a lot of Spanish coming from Cuba, I guess. and that's what I was listening to. But it got me interested in sound in a big way, that particular radio. For some reason, I think we end up having to do this autobiographical stuff for a little bit. Oh, there's an inside of the radio. my parents got me a reel-to-reel tape recorder when I was about 8 or 10 years old, and I have no idea why, other than they had some friends who also got their son a reel-to-reel tape recorder, and he was somebody who was really good at taking things apart. And he took his apart, and it didn't work after a while. And I played around with mine, and it wasn't this particular one. I couldn't find a picture of it, and I don't have that tape recorder anymore, but it was a small one. This is a fetish small tape recorder. This is a spy tape recorder. It's a, I think this one's a cello box. It's probably about this big. And they were the sort of things that tape recorder kids really wanted to have back in the 60s, but they were really expensive and only spies for the flavor. something that I did with these things was this cutting and slicing thing of taking the tape and taking bits of tape and rearranging things in time by taking sticky tape and putting things back together again. I think I might have started off with scissors, but I eventually graduated to using not a knife like that, but a razor blade. I think I'll picture this technique here, not too much. And one of the first things which, I'm trying to see if I can get a sound out of this thing. I did, and I just tried to turn it back on again. It's this really strange pot on here that you keep turning it forever. I made back in, I think it was in 1969, which involved getting a Chuck Berry record from the library and finding the parts that I really liked were the beginnings and the ends, so I just chopped the beginnings off all the songs and attached them to the ends, and then I was in 5 second pieces. The reason it says Buck Cherry there, it's an anagram of Chuck Berry's name, and I didn't do this to quite a while later, but I just found that quite often with performers, you could find really nice names for by switching the letters around and things. And when we did the Plunderphonics box set, I did a lot of that just for fun. There's another one. And that one I like in particular. It's got a bi-line. And that bunch of pieces, there were maybe a dozen of them, whatever number of tracks there were on the record, were called bearings somewhat later on. It was just something I did. Well, let's continue on, because there's at least some pictures. I'm not that enthusiastic about having sound in lectures anyways, because it's hard, unlike the aforementioned visual arts slideshow, where you can have two things going on at once. You can have somebody like me droning on verbally about what's going on the screen. Lectures about sound and music, when you want to make presentations of sound and music, there's a real conflict about talking and playing the sound. You can do both at the same time, but there's a tendency to have this pause while we listen to an example. And I guess I'm always mortified about the possibility that people's attention spans might not really accept this lull from the scintillating live performance, which is supposedly me talking, to listening to a recording, which you can listen to just as easily at home for a given period of time. And I could never decide how long that given period of time might be, whether it might be 5 seconds or 5 minutes. So although there are very brief audio fragments that are part of this lecture, and which we'll hear off the little speaker on the computer here as they come along, they were quite incidental to this PowerPoint presentation. So we'll just plunge ahead. I have no idea at all why that word is up there. it's been quite a while since we turned this thing on. Let's go back. Small one. Come again. Remember, you can ask questions or, unfortunately, the requests. Requests are usually for little musical examples, and they can be really quiet off there. But,
could you speak a little bit about when you first met Burroughs?
Ah, yeah, sure. I can do that by doing this. Okay. I made these quote signs that were stylized for the Plunderphonics box set, 69 being the dates, I'm getting to it, the dates of the Burroughs cuts, which were the earliest ones in that set, and 96 being the other side, 1969. And in 1969, what else happened? I looked at this. Beatles. Oh, does anybody recognize these four people? Does anybody want to venture? Okay, let's go from right to left.
That's
okay.
Anna, yeah, got a characteristic mustache.
George Harrison.
Yeah, close. People have trouble with this one. Charles Bronson, did you say? That's good.
Ginsberg,
that's good too.
Frank Zappa.
You're very close in that as a composer and somebody that has worked with orchestras. It's not that. No, it's Igor Stravinsky. Who said Igor?
Yeah.
All right, okay, Jason. All right, obvious, huh? Yeah. Big star of the 20th century in the classical music world, but that doesn't necessarily make him a big star. And he also doesn't usually wear a mustache, and he definitely had a different hairdo. Now, people have trouble with this one, too. Great. Yeah, that's the young Dolly Parton. And, of course, the Beatle influence once again. This is me at work on my typical notes. Early 70s. Okay, here we go. There he is. Okay. Now, after the Burroughs, probably my first really major tape cutting technique had to do with William Burroughs and William Burroughs' speaking voice in particular. I'd gotten this record on this New York label called ESP, which the album was entitled Call Me Burroughs.